Hello and Aarti, welcome to EPG Paathshala. This is Professor G. Srinivas Reddy, former Professor of Public Administration, Kakati University, Warangal. Today we shall discuss about Chester I. Barnard, who is one of the prominent management thinkers and administrative thinkers. The course of lecture will be like this. I'll first give some details of biodata of Chester Barnard and his major works and his specific contributions, and finally a critique of Chester Barnard, which may further be followed up by a few questions and answers. Let me come back to the beginning. Chester Irving Barnard is one of the most significant of the behavioralist thinkers. I should mention what behavioralism is before we go any further to know about the contributions, specific contributions of Barnard. Behavioralism is a theory or an approach in both management and public administration, which has come after the classical theories and the neoclassical theories, which are also known as human relations theories. Behavioralism basically says that in classical theory, what has been said is the principles of administration. Classical theory is trying to advance some principles, saying that you follow these principles, by following that administration will be efficient, effective and economic. So to ensure administrative efficiency or efficient administration, you have to follow these principles. Now, this is something like saying what should be done in public administration. But real theory of administration or public administration should be one which guides us as to what we should do. But before that, it should tell us what it is. What is public administration after all? So the classical theory has gone to the second question, bypassing the first question, namely, what is public administration? Of course, Woodrow Wilson would have mentioned public administration is policy execution, it is the activities of officials, it is there in executive branch. But more than that, we need to know what exactly is the existing situation of administration. By knowing that, we can discover or apply some of the good principles and make administrative actions more rational, more efficient and more productive. So behavioralism is actually trying to give us an understanding of what really is administration, contrary to classical theory, which is telling us how administration should be, how it should be reformed, how it should be changed, what are the parameters on which it should be improved and all. But before that, it's something like, to borrow an example from a medical field, a good doctor is one who diagnoses or identifies the disease, then prescribes the medicine. Identification of disease is very important. If diagnosis is not properly done, medicine also may be wrongly given. Suppose there is a doctor who is just straight away giving medicine without investigating what is real problem of the patient. The doctor has little chance of being successful doctor. Similarly, in administrative theory, the behavioralist theories are trying to help us by focusing on the realities or realistic factual aspects of administration, and also about the informal organization. Informal organization really exists, and classical thinkers did not pay attention to this. This is the brief background. And Chester Barnard, coming to his little biodata, he was born in the year 1886 in United States of America. He was educated at Harvard University. He was the president, in our language, chief executive of the Bell Telephone Company from 1927 to 48. He was also president of the prestigious Rockefeller Foundation and General Education Board from 1948 to 52. Further, during the Second World War, he was president of the United Service Organization. Now, from this background, it becomes apparent that during his career, he managed business organizations or for-profit organizations, non-profit or government organizations, educational institutions and philanthropic organizations also. For the information of students, let me mention, philanthropic means charitable or service organizations. So therefore, in Chester Barnard, you have the background of a seasoned manager of business as well as government. He was not only a successful executive, but he was also a very successful academic. He had a brilliant scholarly mind. Barnard is credited to have laid the groundwork for the philosophy of management and administration. Let me just mention that philosophy is about the ultimate ends. Philosophy is about what is the purpose of administration? What is the purpose of management? Management is not there just for the sake of giving some jobs to managers. So management must have some basic purposes, the ultimate purposes, and what exactly is that has been the interest of Chester Barnard. Chester Barnard has taken an interdisciplinary approach. He has used inputs or understanding from sociology, psychology, and abstract reasoning and logic to develop his ideas. And he has followed what is known as social systems approach. Social systems approach is viewing administration as a subsystem of the society. Barnard believed that administration or public administration does not exist in a vacuum. It is surrounded by so many things like the government, the social milieu, the culture, the business compulsions, the technology, all those things. So everything has its own influence, and therefore Chester Barnard has a very broad approach to administration. Chester Barnard was influenced by the writings of several of his contemporary management thinkers like Oliver Sheldon, George Elton Mayo, Mary Parker Follett, and Herbert Simon. The reflections of their influence are found in the ideas that were explicated or posited by Chester Barnard. Some of the major ideas of Chester Barnard we shall discuss in the course of this lecture, and they are number one, the acceptance theory of authority. Number two, organization as a cooperative system. Number three, his ideas on contribution, satisfaction, equilibrium. Number four, formal and informal organizations. Number five, communication. And finally, his ideas about functions of the executive. Let me come back to the first one. Barnard says that superior authority is a fiction, means it's only a creation, it's not real. What Barnard is saying is that we generally believe that authority lies with the bosses and responsibility lies with the subordinates. Barnard does not accept this. In this, what we are saying is superiors have authority. Barnard says this is a fiction. This is imaginary. You're only just assuming without objectively knowing what really is happening. And Barnard says that authority is not there with the superiors. Authority is there with the subordinates. Why he says this is, he gives a definition of what authority is. If we look at this definition, it becomes apparent that Barnard is not thinking that the location of authority is with the superiors. The definition is roughly like this. Authority is the character of communication in a formal organization, whereby the person to whom the communication is given accepts that communication to govern the behavior, his own behavior. Let me just pay some attention to some components of this. Firstly, authority is the character of communication. There is no authority without communication. So therefore, he has a theory of communication also. If somebody wants to be really effective, in wielding the authority. In fact, authority is a central concept of management and administration. That is the reason why managers or administrators are also known as authorities. So, in using the word authorities, phrase authorities, we think that these people have authority. But what Bernard says is, authority is related to communication. So, therefore, if somebody wants to be very effective in wielding authority, in exercising authority, he has to be a good communicator. Communication is very, very important for proper exercise of authority. One who has no skill of communication, his communication is poor, tends to be a bad authority or ineffective authority. Secondly, he says authority is the character of communication in a formal organization. He is bringing in the concept of formal organization. A formal organization is official organization, as shown in the organization chart. In some administrative organizations, if you want to understand what that organization is, you can request somebody over there to give you a chart for a quick understanding. So-and-so is the director or chief executive or CEO, MD. Under him, there are four authorities or vice presidents or department heads. Under them, there are, you know, the deputies, and the hierarchy comes down. So, authority is communication which takes place in a formal organization. Thereby, he is saying that authority is linked to communication and also linked to formal organization. And more importantly, authority is the character of communication that is accepted. Communication, all communication, I think we make an assumption that whatever communication happens, bosses tell many things to subordinates, colleagues tell many things to their own colleagues, peers, and they assume that, okay, it's being done, it will be taken care of. But this is not true. This is where Bernard, like other behavioralists like Simon, is trying to have a look of the reality of administration. Reality is that all communication is not accepted. Certain part of communication or certain communications are accepted, certain communications are not accepted. Now he goes to, this is where he brings in the acceptance theory of authority. He says, only accepted authorities, accepted communication is authority. So therefore, to put it in a kind of formula, authority is equal to communication plus acceptance. Accepted communication, if I am a boss or if I am somebody, I am asking somebody to do something. If that person accepts that and follows that up in his personal behavior, this is another last point in the definition of authority. It is both accepting and reflecting in one's behavior. You accept it, simply you nod your head, say that yes, yes, sir, okay, sir. But next moment, you don't really follow what is said. So, following that, to govern your behavior, you behave the way the communication intends you to behave. Then there is authority. So, in authority, there is formal organization, there is communication, acceptance, behavior becoming in unison with what communication is. Behavior going on the lines in which communication is made. Now, we come to another aspect of Bernard's contribution. This is acceptance theory of authority, which is the other side of fiction of superior authority. Authority is accepted communication. Therefore, I said, authority or A is equal to communication plus acceptance, AC, C plus AC. Now, he did a lot of research as to why, under what circumstances people accept communication. People accept communication to govern their behavior if four conditions are fulfilled. These four conditions, if they are fulfilled, communication turns into authority. These four conditions are those which relate to acceptance. If a subordinate has to accept, four things he should have. First, he should understand what the communication is. Now, the kind of language that we sometimes use is such that it is hi-fi kind of language, the elite kind of language. Whatever be the language, you are speaking Telugu, Hindi, English, French, German, Latin, whatever language it is, there is always a gap between what elites or, you know, big people speak and small people speak. The ordinary people, what they speak is called dialect. So they have their own language, and some of the words, vocabulary, some words which are there in the language of elites are not there in the language of small people. So therefore, when you speak, you should speak in such a way that the subordinates fully understands what you say. And India is a classic example of problems of people not following authority because of this simple reason. We were governed by British for a very long time, and English became a medium of instruction. And even now, although Hindi and other regional media have come into play, English basically remains the principal mode of communication as far as national government or some of the state governments are concerned. Or else even the kind of local language like Telugu, Hindi or whatever it is, if the language is such that ordinary people don't understand because that dialect is not used, so there are chances that people don't understand and therefore they don't follow. So there should be clarity in the language. The language that is used should be having vocabulary from the people, vocabulary which is known to the people, and it should be given in such a way that people grasp what you are saying. Sometimes hurriedly made communications are also creating problems. You speak at great speed and the fellow for whom your communication is meant does not understand it equally fast. So there is a communication lag. So this is the first condition. Okay, this first test is passed. Communication is made, subordinates understands the same way as the superior intends. Sometimes communication bottlenecks are such that you say something, it is understood as something differently. The second important condition for communication to turn into authority, to get the acceptance, is the person's ability to follow the communication or to comply with the contents of communication. Say for example, the boss is asking a lame fellow, a lame employee to run fast and catch up something, get something very fast. Since the fellow is lame, limping, and he cannot go that very fast as expected by boss, and the communication fails, authority fails to materialize. Or you are telling too many things and the fellow's ability to remember is limited. You tell 100 things, asking the subordinate to remember all that. There is every chance that the fellow may not remember. He may remember some, he may forget some. So the boss may be annoyed. What is it? I have assigned you 100 things you have not done. And there is a chance that the fellow will fail to do that. That is the reason why sometimes formal communication is considered important, because everything is reduced to writing and you can see that. But informal communication, of course, is more effective than formal communication. There is a personal touch in that. The next important thing is the employee or the subordinate should think that the communication is not against the organizational interest. Sometimes it's not essential that the bosses always give communications or orders which are always in the furtherance of organizational objectives. Sometimes they may tell, maybe because of wrong understanding, maybe because of some personal motivation, they may ask the subordinate to do something which is going against the interest of the organization. So in that case also, the subordinate is in a dilemma, because every employee joins an organization with certain expectations. And the expectation is that you are there to serve the organization, not to harm the organization. Suppose there is an order which is going to harm the organization, the subordinates gets into a dilemma. He may not immediately comply with the order. Therefore, communication fails. So, therefore, the subordinate either should understand that the order given is not against the organization, or even if he understands, maybe because of wrong understanding, the superior should clarify how it is going to help the organization to achieve something substantial. And finally, there is another condition, that is, it should not be against the personal interests of the fellow. After all, we say that human nature is both selfish and unselfish. Human beings, and when we are talking about management or administration, public or private sector, every employee is there as a public servant or business employee in a business organization. Everybody is there to serve some personal interest. They have a family to take care. They need some money. So they have some personal interest. Okay, if some order is such, communication is such, that it is against the personal interest, by doing, by complying, by following a certain communication, the subordinate thinks that he is going to lose, is going to suffer. So he may hesitate to do it. He may not argue openly that it's against his personal interest, but somewhere the action, the compliance will be failing. So thus there are four conditions for the communication to become authority, by meeting with the acceptance. Now, one important thing that needs to be noted here is that Chester Barnard is trying to develop a democratic theory of authority. Democratic theory of authority in the sense that authority is not with the rulers, but with the ruled. Not with the administrators, but with subordinates. So therefore, he has shifted the locale of authority from top to the bottom. Therefore, people say that Barnard has used a bottom-up approach to authority rather than top-down concept of authority. Authority does not, the traditional definition of authority is authority as the command of the superior. Whatever command superior gives, that is authority. But Barnard says the fact is that most of the commands of superiors are not met with acceptance. Therefore, authority is not coming. So therefore, these four conditions are important, and perhaps one important thing, as I mentioned, he has democratized. So he shifted authority from superiors to subordinates. I think this goes well with the democratic organization. Secondly, Barnard is also a behavioralist, as I mentioned. Behavioralism tries to see what is the reality, what is the real ground condition. The ground condition is that, you know, just mere orders are not enough. Orders will be accepted when certain things are there, and those certain things we have mentioned. So he has given a realistic concept of authority, not an idealistic concept of authority. Ideally, what all bosses say should be done by subordinates. And in the democratic conception of authority, there is another thing. I think this is the concept that is gaining ground, and in all business organizations and all that, they are nowadays using the concept of employee empowerment. What employee empowerment says is that even the junior most employee should be given decisional powers, you know, without consulting the superiors. Let them take decisions. By taking decisions, they get experience, and it also believes that knowledge is not the monopoly of superiors. Why subordinates' acceptance is needed is that subordinates are, after all, people who are on the action front. They are at the cutting edge. They are dealing with the people. If you talk about public administration, the public servants are knowing the ground realities. They go to villages, they go to four corners of the cities and slums and all that. They have the knowledge. So therefore, their acceptance is important. Sometimes they may have strong reservations, which are based on facts. If these reservations are taken into consideration, the authority becomes effective and subordinates also become effective and happy in doing things. Now, connected to his theory of acceptance, theory of authority is, there is another concept known as contribution-satisfaction equilibrium. Barnard views employees or subordinates as members of the organization. He uses a word, phrase called members of the organization. Here again, you can see the reflection of a democratic point of view. Earlier, we used to divide employees into authorities and subordinates. Now, he says everybody is a member of the organization. And every member of the organization or every employee, be it an officer or a subordinate, they are joining organization for a two-way relationship. And that two-way relationship is known as contribution hyphen satisfaction equilibrium. What it means is every employee is contributing no matter what is his position. He may be an attender, a peon, or a chief executive. Everybody is contributing. And so one more example of Bernard's democratic ideas, democratization of authority, is evident in his usage of the term members of the organization. He combines all employees in the organization, officers and bosses, subordinates, everybody, and he calls them members of the organization. Everybody is a member of the organization, like in a cooperative or a club, every member is equal. So everybody is a member. And everybody is making contribution. They are equal in the sense that everybody is making contribution and everybody is looking for some satisfaction. Satisfaction is the reward that one gets. Satisfaction is a broad word, more broader than mere salary. Salary, compensation, anywhere expected, but some job satisfaction, all those things are there. So the relation with the employee, between the employee and the organization is two-way. One relation is contribution. Who is contributing? Employees are contributing. And they should receive satisfaction. Who is satisfying? The company or the organization is satisfying. So there should be a match between contribution and satisfaction. Now, when there are three kinds of orders or three kinds of communications an employee may get, these three kinds of orders are orders which are acceptable. Employees implicitly, without any question, without any botheration, simply accept what the boss says. This is what he calls zone of indifference. He doesn't bother. He will follow the orders. And there are some orders which are clearly not acceptable. The fellow will say for example, if some employee is asked to shoot him down, a security guard, at the security post in an organization. If the boss comes and tells, shoot yourself down. This is the fellow will perhaps think that the officer has gone crazy or mad. He will not shoot himself because that's not the expectation. He's supposed to shoot down some intruder who is coming to, burglar. If he is defying his commands and he is not going back, he may do that. So therefore, there are certain expectations, and if you are giving orders which are against those expectations, you clearly don't accept the authority. So you reject the orders. This is one area. In a triangle, if you have an inverted pyramid, at the top it is narrow and at the bottom it is large, the zone of indifference, the triangle can be divided into three blocks. The first block at the sharp edge, small in volume. Second block is certainly bigger, and the last block is much bigger. So orders are of three kinds. Unacceptable at the top, they should be very few. Neither acceptable nor rejectable are those amenable for rejection. So it's in the middle, slightly more than the unacceptable orders. And at the bottom, it should be inverted pyramid. The sense is that most of the orders should be acceptable. So acceptable orders or acceptable communications are what constitute zone of indifference. An organization or employees will be doing well. They will be complying with authority if the zone of indifference is large. If the zone of indifference is small, they will not comply with the communications or orders. Is important here to remember is that an employee should be treated as somebody who is on par with the organization. There are two views in this. Some people think that employee should die for organization. And maybe contrarily, some people think that organization should die for individual. Both are idealistic. What is reality is that organization should survive and individual should survive. Therefore, there should be a match between what an employee contributes and what he gets back from the organization. And this balance should be maintained. This balance is called equilibrium. If contribution is more, satisfaction is less, employee feels frustrated. If contribution is less, satisfaction is more, which means he is getting more than what he is doing. organization will suffer, and ultimately employee also loses the job. So therefore, this is a delicate balance that need to be maintained. The last important contribution of Chester Barnard is about the functions of the executive. This is in fact the title of the book he has authored in 1938, and this is a classic, a bestseller in management public administration literature. He says executives or bosses have four functions. Number one, they have to formulate the purposes of the organization. They should clearly lay down what purpose a particular organization, be it a company or a government department or a public office, what for it is meant. What are the central purposes? Number two, the chief executive or the executives have to secure essential services from the people. There are a company or government department is not one man affair. So there is a boss as well as subordinates. So you have to get services from subordinates. How to get those services? This is second important function. The third important function is establishing a system of communication. What he really means is that communication is central to administration. An efficient administrative organization is one where there is a free flow of communication, unhindered flow of communication, communication going in a democratic way, communication being understood by everybody. So communication meeting all the conditions. So communication channel should be open in organization, and people should not have communication bottlenecks, communication breakdowns. One good example of lack of communication is that people not talking to each other, not meeting eye to eye. There are some occasions where two colleagues, they have some personal rivalry, some problem, and they don't talk to each other, and organization suffers. So there should be free flow of communication. And one more important function of organization is establishing a cooperative system. Barnard says that cooperation is the essence of administration. Everybody should cooperate with each other. See, if cooperation is missing, organization suffers. And finally, also hints that informal organization is important. Informal organization is the opposite of formal organization. Formal organization is official organization where you are either superior to somebody or subordinate to somebody. So you are dealing with bosses and subordinates. But in informal communication, you are dealing with friends. You are dealing with people who share similar ideas, interests, and all that. Barnard says that informal organization should be established. What he really means is that people should be on friendly terms with each other. They should freely talk to each other. They should love to see each other. They should have some common interest to cultivate friendships and all that. So this kind of informality, not merely, I think sometimes when the boss tells something with authority and all that, subordinate may not accept. You may say that no. But when the boss says, please, Mr. So-and-so, please do it for me and all that. So he is invoking informal relation. He need not say please, but he's still saying please. So this is informality. So treating him like a friend, treating him like an equal, or sometimes begging him to do something. I think it meets with positive response and administrative jobs are done. So these are the functions of the executive mentioned by Chester Barnard. And interestingly, they contrast a lot with the kind of functions that the classical thinkers would have mentioned. The classical thinkers like Henry Fayol say, you divide the work, you have unity of command, you have unity of direction, you have XYZ kind of things. They are saying, but here he is saying all realistic things. He is trying to give a lot of understanding of realities of administration. So therefore, Chester Irving Barnard is a major contributor to behavioral school of administration. His basic contributions are on acceptance theory of authority, on fiction of superior authority, on contribution satisfaction equilibrium, and with these things I think anybody's understanding of administration will be widened. Without this understanding, people may simply bank upon authority, bank upon orders of the superiors. So let's recap what Chester Barnard has said. Chester Barnard is a behavioralist. He is focusing on realities of administration. In that job, he has given a new theory of authority, or a novel theory of authority known as acceptance theory of authority. He has enlightened us as to what are the conditions under which any communication gets acceptance of the subordinates. And to that extent, he is contributing for the understanding of the organizational realities. And he is also saying that an employee's relation with the organization is two-way process. The companies or the organizations, departments or government authorities should not think that the employees are at their beck and call. They have simply to carry the orders given by superior. This is wrong. There is a two-way relationship. They are contributing and therefore they deserve some satisfaction, something back to them, and the bosses should pay attention to that. And finally, he has also mentioned the fiction of superior authority. Authority, the superior should never feel that they have all the authority. And of course, they can feel that they have authority only when they get the compliance and acceptance of subordinates. A real authority is one who has acceptance, approval of the subordinates. So therefore, Bernard's theory is a democratic theory of administration. He, if his ideas are followed, I think administration will be both effective and democratic. I think these are the days in which every country is moving towards democracy. The hitherto capitalist, the hitherto Marxian, the Marxist countries or theocracies, dictatorships, everywhere there is onward march of democracy. I think he has given an ideal, system of administration or the concepts that are relevant for building up a democratic and effective authority system. So this is essentially the contribution of Chester, Irving, Bernard, a very notable thinker in public administration belonging to the realm of behavioralism. Together with Herbert Simon, he has laid much of the foundations and groundwork for behavioralist theories of public administration.